Welcome to another edition of Celebrate Life, Learning, Laughing, and Loving. My name is Wayne Braverman, and I am your host for the next half hour. It is my great honor and privilege to welcome my extra special guest, Rabbi Rick Weiner and Mazel the dog. Welcome, Rick, and welcome, Mazel, who's already dozed off and gone to sleep.
Thank you, Wayne. Thank you. It's great to be here with you.
It is wonderful to have you here. I know Rick from our time in Toastmasters, which we're both members of. Rick is the now retired, immediate past District 31, not governor.
Director. As district director, we complete our term on June 30th. So as July 1st, I am the immediate past district director, and that gives me an opportunity to visit more clubs and be unofficial, as well as delivering awards that people have earned throughout the year.
Yeah. Now, for people at home, because Rick and I are both Toastmasters, if you get out a piece of paper, you are invited to count all the ahs and ums that may fall out of our mouths during our time together. Yes?
Please do count them and send it to us, because I would like to know if I say any ahs and ums. And those two don't count.
I think they're going to need probably a very small piece of paper. They'll watch us now loaded up with all the filler words that we're taught not to use.
That's right.
But you are a rabbi. You are a justice of the peace. You're not associated with any one temple, correct?
That is correct. I work independently. In my work, I have the privilege of working with individuals, with couples, assisting them with their weddings, assisting them with funerals, with other life cycle events. By doing that, I feel that I have the best of both worlds.
You, on your website, you say you're there to support people to find their spiritual selves.
I think that's very important. There's a lot of people that are confused or don't really enjoy organized religion that much, yet they feel a need for their spirituality that don't fit into the box, so to speak. What I like to do is take people and support them in finding where they fit best, listening to people because they're right, no matter what they think, because those are their feelings, and help them to get through whatever needs they have.
And there are a lot of people looking for that in their lives right now. It seems like a lot of people seem to be turning away from church, but still looking for God, still looking for the spiritual part of their lives. And perhaps there are a lot of people who are confused as to where that is.
Well, that's true, especially if the Jews are going to church. But on the other hand...
Well, they'd be going to temple.
Exactly. But on the other hand, there is a huge number of people, Jews especially, I don't know about non-Jews, but there's a huge number of Jews that are not affiliated with any congregation. Mm-hmm. And there are times in life when we do need some spiritual guidance, when we do have an illness in the family, or we have something to celebrate. We want to often find somebody that will honor our wishes and help us to celebrate in the way that we want to. And that's one of the things I specialize with.
Has your life been a spiritual journey?
Oh, my heavens, absolutely. I've always been, I don't want to use the term religious, but looking for my path, following my drama, so to speak. My first encounter with deep spirituality is I was in Israel back in 1972, and I was at the Wailing Wall. And while I was there, I was praying at the wall, and I was really deep into myself, into prayer. All of a sudden, I thought I was levitating off the earth. Huh. I had to quickly look down to see if I was still on the ground. I mentioned that to some of my rabbis, my teachers at the time, and they said to me, "You absolutely had a very strong spiritual encounter, a special relationship with God at that moment." Ever since then, I've never forgotten that experience, and I've been able to build on it.
What's beyond that time in your life? Talk about a time in your life where you absolutely were positive that God was there with you, that you could feel Him in your presence.
That's a daily occurrence. I think right now in my life, and I'm going to talk about now, mm-hmm. because it maybe it sounds a little bit ridiculous to say it's a daily occurrence, but it is. I really do feel a connection with my higher being, my God. Mm-hmm. I have chickens in my backyard now. Very earthy little creatures. I will take out a chair and sit in the coop area with the chickens and feed them by hand. I can feel nature. What is spirituality? Mm-hmm. It is nature.
Yep.
I absolutely. Can feel that experience of the very, what's the proper word to use? These animals that are very primitive coming over to me. Am I just sitting there and watching them? That is a spiritual experience in itself. It's being one with nature.
You have a connection with other living beings.
With Mazel. And my wife, of course.
Of course. Both important.
Well, she's the most important.
Yes. You, when you were a child, did you think about becoming a rabbi, or were there other things you... Because you seem to have a lot of things in your background.
I do have a lot in my background, and that's a really good question. From the time I was quite young, I always thought, gee, I'd really like to be a rabbi. And I doubted myself. I thought, I don't have the knowledge. I can't do it. All the can'ts in my mind. And I went into business. First, I went to college for music, and then I went into business. My dad was in business, and I always followed my own drummer that way. Mm-hmm. I met my wife 1994 originally, but we started dating in 1995. The first time we got together, we were sitting in someone's house. It was a weekend party, and she came over, and we just got to know each other. And she said, tell me, what do you want to do when you grow up?
When you grow up?
We never grow up, hopefully. I always want to be a kid. Uh-huh. And I told her, I don't know why, but I actually told her about my dream that I always wanted to be a rabbi. And then we talked about other things. About 15 years ago, she said to me, whatever happened to your dream? Huh. And I thought for a few moments, and I was working, I was in business, and she said, I'll do whatever it takes to support you. And I found a way, became a rabbi, and I've been the happiest I've ever been in my life. Hmm. I never want to retire, I want to just keep going. And sharing what the gifts that I have with others.
Mm-hmm. What do you consider your primary gifts?
Well, Wayne, I've known you for a few years now. Mm-hmm. And I consider one of my gifts is getting to know people, to share my experiences with them, and to share their experiences with me, to connect with others. There is nothing better in this world than caring about other people. And that's something I really strive at doing on a regular basis.
In my experience with you, and it's been a few years, empathy. You have a lot of kindness, but you also have a lot of empathy. You listen to people, and you're able to put yourself into their shoes. That's a wonderful gift, and we don't have enough of that in the world today, I believe.
That's true, because in today's world, everybody is out for survival. It's mm-hmm. difficult today. It's a two-income world. It's so hard for the average person to just get through day to day. But when I suppose when you get to my age and you've gotten through the days today, the opportunity to really be supportive to others gives me the greatest gifts of all. Mm-hmm. I absolutely love officiating weddings, for example, being with people at one of the happiest times in their lives. But in all honesty, I get more satisfaction and more personal experiences by officiating a funeral. It gives me an opportunity to be there for people, to support them through very tough times. That is part of life, the same as birth. But when you're with people at their tough times, and able to make it a little bit better for them, to me, that is what life is all about. That's what we're supposed to do.
It's during those times when they need you the most.
I agree, and that's why I try to be there for them.
You weren't always a rabbi. You went to the New England Conservatory of Music.
Boston Conservatory of Music.
Boston Conservatory of Music.
The better school, yes.
The better school. The less known school, but still a good school. Today, you are still a musician.
You know, that's a funny story. Back when I was in elementary school, I wanted to take an instrument. And my mother didn't want me to. She said, you won't stick with it. And I begged and begged and begged in fourth grade and fifth grade. I begged, and finally in sixth grade, she said, okay. What do you want to play? I said, anything. And she said, violin. I said, no. And then she said, how about clarinet? I said, fine. And my parents bought me a clarinet and sent me out for lessons. Well, I'm in my 60s, and I still play professionally at this day. Someday I might not play anymore, so she might have been right. But up until now, I still play. In fact, I just finished a series of concerts on the North Shore.
Mm-hmm. How many instruments do you play?
I'm not sure, Wayne. That's a tough question.
Well, there's at least three of them.
Well, I play all the different clarinets, from E-flat soprano to contra alto clarinet. Mm-hmm. I play saxophone, a little bit of flute. I'm not really that proficient. A little oboe. Play most of the woodwind instruments.
What's your favorite?
Clarinet.
Clarinet. Benny Goodman.
Yeah, Benny Goodman, but I'm really classically trained, mm-hmm. and I love to play classical music, but I also enjoy playing jazz. So it's kind of like my life. I've learned to come and go with the flow and enjoy whatever I'm in. One lesson I've learned, and I was talking to somebody earlier today about this. I had a woman today tell me, oh, so terrible, the weather, it's raining out, it's miserable. I said, it's a beautiful day. She looked at me and I said, can you change it? She said, no, then love it. So we learn to love what we can't change. And we appreciate more.
That's acceptance.
Acceptance.
Of the things we don't have the power to change.
And I'm not going to tell him he's doing the wrong thing by making it rain.
No. The gardens need it.
That's right.
As of the date of this taping, the gardens need it. If you're watching this in January, you're going to look outside and go, what? We have 3 feet of snow outside. What's he talking about? But when we're filming this, which is early August, we need the rain.
Tomorrow it's supposed to be in the 90s.
With feel like temperatures of in the hundreds. With humidity. Well, that's the beauty of New England is we get to experience what the South experiences for a little while. We're not stuck with it. Then we'll go on to something else. So we're never bored with it. It always gives us something to talk about.
Well, as the saying goes, if you don't like the weather, just wait a minute.
Mm-hmm. Have you come across people who are just so spiritually lost, who just don't know, are looking for some answers? How do you reach down to somebody like that and help bring them up or help them to find what it is that they're looking for?
That's a good question, and I think the answer is within. When I have somebody that is really depressed, lost, and as you said, not knowing which end is up mm-hmm. spiritually, I usually ask them, when were you happy?
Ah.
Then I let them talk. And then they can reach inside and pull that out. They have the answers. I don't. Once they come across that time in their lives and in their hearts, then they're able to be found again. It's not my words of wisdom. It's the individual's words of wisdom.
Mm-hmm. You and I both have an experience with a company that helped people with seminars. Do you remember an exercise called What Do You Want?
Yes. That's a long time ago, Wade.
I'll remind you of the questions.
Yeah.
What do you want? How can you get it? And then the biggest one of all, what's the experience you're looking for?
I remember.
That brings back memories to you?
Oh, it definitely brings back memories. That's a tough exercise.
It's a great exercise.
It is.
It brings you down to the essence of what you want. Oftentimes, we look at the material things that we want. New job, new car, house, lots of money. Those are just surface things, because what we really want is what's the experience that we're looking for.
That's right.
So I'm going to cut through the first two questions and go right to the essence of it. What's the experience you're looking for in life?
Wow. I did not expect this. The experience I'm looking for in life, I suppose if I really think back, when my dad passed away, the funeral home, the obituary never made it to the newspaper in time. The funeral home was packed, standing room only. And then I realized what kind of a man he was, how good a person he was. But I always knew that, mm-hmm. but I realized other people knew that as well. What do I want most in life? To be half the person my dad was, to be known as being a good person. That would make me happy.
What was your dad like?
He was a wonderful man. My father was not an educated man. He dropped out of high school to join the Army during World War II. Mm-hmm. And he went into business when he got out of the Army. And he worked hard. He worked very hard. And he was the most abundant human being that you had ever known. People that owed him money would come to him and he'd lend them money. Even though they owed him more than they could ever pay, he would just give it to them because they needed it. Mm-hmm. He was the type of person that people learned to love because of who he was, just how he lived his life. He was a spiritual man. In Hebrew, we would say he was a tzaddik. He was a good person.
He was somebody who reached, people were more important to him than the material.
Absolutely, absolutely.
What is it he did for a living?
Well, when I was a young child, he had a toy store.
Oh, that must have been fun.
But he closed that business down when I was still young, and he went into the used furniture business. Mm-hmm. He would go into people's homes and buy furniture and bring it to the store and clean it up and sell it and deliver it. And he did that till he retired, and he also did a little bit of real estate. Hmm. He was, as I said, he was a very hard worker.
You have a list of things you've done for a living. What were some of your favorites? Beyond being a rabbi, because I know that that's today, and I know how much that means to
Wayne,
you.
Wayne, they were all my favorites. As you already mentioned, I went to school for music, mm-hmm. and then I went into business with my dad, and I helped him in his business, and I took it over for a while. And when I was 21, I was appointed a constable in Peabody and then Salem and a few other cities, and I was serving civil process. I was a tax collector collecting excise taxes.
Ooh.
I didn't enjoy that too much, but I did that. Then I went into other businesses. I went into the printing business. I went into the cellular phone business. I did a lot of little things here and there. And I always found that I never got bored. I always wanted to get up to go to work. And I always said, if I don't like work, I'm going to change. Mm-hmm. None of these businesses were just a year or two. They were over a long period of time. And they were very enjoyable. They were great experiences. And that's kind of what made me who I am.
You have children?
I have three children of my own and two stepchildren with my wife. Mm-hmm. We also have five grandchildren and two more on the way.
Oh, my. And you have goats. For the moment.
For the moment. I found a way to get rid of poison ivy. and that's renting goats. They're not mine. Fellow comes over to the house, he sets up an electric fence and puts goats in there. And he came along and moved it a few times, and they just chomp away and get it right out through the roots. It's wonderful. It's nutritious for the goats, and I don't have to worry about being itchy. I let them do all the work. It's wonderful to watch. It's fun. I love the animals. And hopefully tomorrow he's going to come and take them all away.
All the poison ivy's gone.
The poison ivy's gone.
And it will not grow back, in theory.
It probably will because it's natural. But right now it's out from the roots, and hopefully we'll be able to keep it at bay.
Somebody also mentioned some of the other things. Were you really in the circus, or was that just a make-believe thing?
I wasn't in the circus. I was a clown, though.
You were a clown. Okay.
I had a friend of mine who was a professional clown, and he taught me. And I did do some professional clowning, but not circus. But it was. I used to do private parties. And
did you have a beard at that point?
No. Well, actually, part of the time, yes. I grew my first beard in 1980, 81, and I've had one ever since. Excuse me. But most of the time, I did not have a beard as a clown, and I was a hobo clown.
Oh.
So it was the black makeup and the white and the being mime? A hobo.
A mime?
No, I actually spoke. I actually spoke. I wasn't a mime. My teacher was a mime. He had studied with Marcel Marceau.
Oh.
So he really knew his material. But I did not do miming.
Did you scare children?
No. Children loved me. I used to make them the balloon animals and then have them sit in my lap and I'd play with them. And it was always a wonderful experience.
When I was a camp director, I was surprised to find out how many kids would be scared of clowns. I never quite understood why.
Something very strange to you can be frightening.
Okay.
However, it depends upon how you approach the child.
Uh-huh. Yes.
That makes a big difference. Now, if you're a camp counselor, you also know that if you came on with strong authority with the children, they're going to be timid and not want to be with you.
Oh, yeah.
But if you came along as a friendly person with a smiling face, they'll befriend you.
Absolutely.
Children are smart. People don't realize it, but they're very smart.
Oh, yeah.
And when I would do clowning, I would just be one with the children. As I said, I never want to grow up.
Mm-hmm. I loved being around the children as a camp director, and I always tried to be friendly with them. But one of the things that I learned was what they called the camp director look. And we had like 200 people in camp, so you have to keep some type of order when you're trying to get people to move from one place to another.
Show us that look.
The camp director look was, and you aim it right at somebody.
That's the school principal look.
That's the school principal look. See, I learned it as the camp director look. And I learned that you have to master that look, because if you don't, they're not going to take you seriously.
It's true. It's true. Children work with fear and they work with love.
Mm-hmm.
Both.
Yep.
And it really depends upon how you're working with them. And if it's a day-to-day basis where you have a couple hundred children, you need them to care about you but also have a little bit of fear. It does work.
There are a lot of adults today that are living in fear. They're not sure about the future. They're not sure what their life is going to be like. As a rabbi, I've had other clergy on, and towards the end of the show, I give them the opportunity to talk to people who might be feeling down, lost, needing some type of comfort. I give you that invitation if there's something that you would like to say.
Thank
to
you,
those
Wayne.
People.
Thank you. I think that for people that are having a challenge in life, that really feel that they don't know which end is up, it could be empowering to know that you do have that within you. That sometimes it just takes talking with a friendly person, being there, listening, and knowing that your feelings are real and they should be valued. If someone says you're wrong and you shouldn't feel that way, dismiss that person. If somebody wants to listen to you and be supportive, that's the friend to have. And we all need other people in our lives. We weren't created individually. Mm-mm. I remember a lecture with Rabbi Reuven Balka, who said that women and men were not created equally. But for every man, there's a woman. For every woman, there's a man. And we need each other. And it takes both to be one. It takes both to be one whole. If we expand upon that, it takes more than one person to be a whole. And we need to have that opportunity to have another human being in our lives that we can talk to and we can confide in, that'll listen to us without judgment, because judgment's the worst thing we can do, without judgment and just love. And that can be supportive to our lives and help us get to the next plateau of satisfaction and happiness.
We are taught to trust in God, to believe that God will lead us to our next step. When you look at somebody like Moses, God certainly led Moses, but what God didn't tell him is what that journey was going to be like along the way. And there are other people who had that same experience that we find about in both the Jewish faith and the Christian faith, who they believe they're following God, but then that journey is so rough to get to that end, oh, wow, here we are thing. And maybe that's because if God said, Rick, I'm going to take you on this journey, but I'm going to make it very difficult for you. You'll be almost penniless. I'm going to tear down your house. I'm going to make it so the people don't have anything to do with you for a while. You're going to experience all of that. And then we'll see what the ending's going to be like. You might say, well, God, thank you very much. And perhaps there might be a better person to use for this thing. Do you ever have that type of experience where you feel like you're being led and it's rough?
You know, Wayne, I've had the opposite kind of experience.
Huh.
I have been married and divorced, and I went through a very, very, very difficult divorce. I had my children ripped out of my life, and that was tough.
Mm-hmm.
And it was, I could have turned around and said, God, why are you doing this to me? But he's not. He gives us free will. He doesn't do it to us. Instead, I looked more into my spirituality. I looked more into God for support. And that's what got me through the toughest times.
And that's what can get us all through that as well.
It's finding our faith and reaching for it. That's why we call it faith.
Yeah. I want to thank you very much for being my guest on this show. You will be a guest on the next show as well.
I'm excited and looking forward to it, Wayne. I always enjoy spending time with you.
And with you. Thank you for joining us for Celebrate Life. My name's Wayne Braverman. We'll see you the next time.